All right, good morning. It's all nice to have you all back after the party last night. So after getting some surprise remarks on our sample boards, I thought I'd show a little bit on the development before continuing. So this is what I showed you yesterday, a bit of a mix actually of different systems. When I joined the field in 2008, it wasn't actually so uncommon to see sample holders that looked like this, with some kind of RF cable sticking out, but otherwise pretty much taken from DC measurements. Up to a few hundred megahertz, they carry pretty far, but you see nasty oscillations on your pulses and so on. So then we move to, move to this setup. But there's actually been quite a bit of development. So there's some publications on, well, pretty much two pieces of art, multi-layer PCBs with many different kinds of connectors for different frequency ranges. This was the first generation. I think it has some like 7 layers with the RF layers and DC wires on different layers to shield them from each other. Systematic studies of crosstalk. Then some recent development, they added an interposer chip that is small and simple, can be exchanged along with a sample while still maintaining good high frequency components. And we are developing ourselves a similar idea here. This is again a circuit board based on similar designs. You see pads for bias or for stabilizing capacitors, strip lines for readout. There's connectors here for buried RF lines that go to the sample. Then in the middle here, we have a silicon interposer chip. So the idea is that eventually this is a small microfabricated chip where the sample itself sits in the middle, because the samples are typically small and made of precious material. This is about 2 centimeters. You see the RF lines going to the sample. One new idea here is to also use high loss strip lines to connect the DC wires in order to suppress any resonances in the DC wiring. In the end, I think it's important not only to have clean RF hygiene for the high frequency lines, but also maintain the same principle for DC lines so that they don't start to resonating when they're resonate when they're excited by the RF lines.
Which group published the reviews of all
That was David Riley, these ones. Yes. He's in Australia focusing on these kind of things, also cooling down FPGAs to look at controllable, scalable control techniques and so on. This probably is published as well by now. All right, so let's continue. Maybe I'll just jump out here where we left off. So last time focused on single electron control, readout, how we can use magnetic and electric fields to control the spins using the spin orbit interaction on micromagnets. Then I started to introduce 2-electron spins, and that's where I'll continue today. So first, explain the basics, and then actually discuss another type of qubit that adds 1 extra spin to, again, well, in some way simplify the control. And, well, we'll see. I'll certainly start, I think, with decoherence, and then hyperfine interaction may have to wait till the next lecture. So let's see. We got this far. We said we take 2 electron spins now to encode a single qubit, and the states that are most convenient to use are most mainstream. Are the m equals 0 states, so they have 0 net angular momentum. You can either write them as a singlet or m equals 0 triplet, or just as the super or as up and down up states. So these are the basis states. And the control that is applied to the qubit is, on the one hand, a field gradient between the left and the right dot. So this gives a Zeeman splitting between those 2 states. That's the qubit processor on the z-axis in the Bloch sphere. Or we can switch on exchange interaction, which is electrically controllable. And pictorially, you can think of the 2 electrons swapping places. So this is a nice cartoon picture. But to actually, well, build more confidence and understand it more deeply and quantitatively, of course, we need to work with Hamiltonians. And another very useful kind of intermediate tool between intuitive understanding and real calculations is this energy diagram. So what you see here is the energy of each of these states, the singlet, T plus, T naught, T minus, so T plus is up, up, and down, down, as a function of the detuning. And this detuning is just the potential difference between the left and the right dot, or more precisely, the energy difference between the so-called 1-1 state, where both electrons are separated in the 2 dots, or 0-2 states, where both electrons are in 1 dot, And since they have different charge distributions, you can change this detuning by applying gate voltages to each dot. So in practice, these would be these gates, for example, but you can think of raising or tilting this double well potential for the purpose of understanding how the qubit is operated. And so what I'd like to go through is, in a semi-formal way, how to construct this energy diagram, how each of the elements show up here. So let's start out with just two separate states, no tunnel coupling, so a big barrier in between. Then as you change the detuning epsilon here, it's clear that they have different energies. So you would have two straight lines for not too large changes, so the linear change, that cross somewhere, but without tunnel coupling, they, well, really have a level crossing. The Hamiltonian for that in these two levels, so we just take the charge state so far, would just, well, you can add a constant, but be the detuning on the diagonal that changes the two energies. Now, in addition, you need to consider that the triplet state has a symmetric spin component, so it needs to have an anti-symmetric orbital component for the Pauli principle, whereas the singlet state can have a symmetric orbital component of the wave function. Therefore, you can put the singlet into twice the ground state, if you think in terms of single particles, whereas for the triplet, you need one excited state. Otherwise, if you take the same state here, it cancels out. You cannot symmetrize the, well, single wave function or wave function made up of single orbitals. It's just the Pauli principle. You cannot put two fermions into the same state. Now, this means the triplet now has an excited orbital state in here, and that means the splitting, here's the same in harmonic oscillators, there's a finite energy splitting between the singlet state with two electrons and the triplet state with two electrons in one dot. Of course, this only applies, or is only really relevant, the electrons are in one dot. If they're separated, it doesn't really matter whether you take the ground or excited states because the bonding and antibonding states are nearly degenerate and it doesn't basically matter. They have nearly the same energy. All right, so we've seen that our triplet 0,2 is higher in energy. Otherwise, it's also the 0,2 state with charge on the right. So it's parallel to our singlet line. And if we introduce that into our Hamiltonian, we just add a constant to this singlet 0,2 component. Now, so far we've neglected tunnel coupling. And here we go. Now, let's switch on tunnel coupling. Consider that the two electrons can tunnel from one dot to the other. If you tunnel couple these states here, what happens is that you open avoided crossing. So the singlet, which moves from 1,1 to 0,2 here, opens this gap. The width is just twice the tunnel coupling. You may know that from many other types of qubits, standard two-level system. But if you look at the triplet, that tunnel coupling would only happen up here, because here the triplet cannot move to from 1,1 to 0,2 yet. In principle, this would be here, but in practice, for most purposes, not always, you can ignore this triplet up here, just ignore that a triplet 0,2 exists and throw that out of the picture. So this simplifies us again. We now have, can combine this state with the tunnel coupling, the singlet 1,1 and the singlet 0,2, which are included here. We can combine this, well, we have a tunnel coupling between the two, first of all. We can diagonalize that and write write this as one hybridized singlet that just corresponds to this state with a distribution that depends on the tuning. And what is left now is just an energy difference between the triplet, always in 1,1, and the singlet. So it's basically the difference between those levels. And these can now be changed as a function of epsilon, or therefore as a function of time, if epsilon is time dependent. Any questions so far? Good to have a little bit of mass for waking up. All right, so here's our exchange coupling now. And you see that we can, this is what we use to control the qubit dynamics. We can vary that just by changing the detuning. So finally, we haven't considered the Zeeman splitting yet. Again, here are our four spin states, m equals 0 states in our computational subspace. which I've discussed so far. Then there's a T plus and the T minus spin with M equals state with M equals plus one or minus one. These are split off by the Zeeman splitting on each of the electrons. So their energies are parallel to the T naught here, but higher or lower. And well, what we typically use are Zeeman fields on the order of 10 millitesla to 1 tesla, depending what physics we're interested in. So now how do we put this onto a Bloch sphere? As I said, the computational states are these two. So let's, for the most purposes, ignore this dashed line. And as I said, we can now put them on the Bloch sphere, and then we can identify these different control modes with this level diagram. This free precession in the field gradient, I'll tell you where this comes from, it's often related to nuclear spins, is now happening at a very large negative detuning, where any 0,2 occupation is completely forbidden. It's too high in energy, so you can think of the electrons as being completely separated, as you see from the singlet and the T naught being degenerate. Then the qubit can just precess around the up, down, and down, up states. You could say that these states, actually T naught and S, the eigenstates really turn into these two, and there's a splitting that's given by the field gradient. But if you then go to somewhat slightly less negative detuning, where the J is finite, but you're still mostly into 1,1, so mostly separated electrons, just the singlet slightly hybridized with 0,2, you have this exchange here, and you can understand why this is happening from a virtual occupation of 0,2. So in order for those electrons to swap places, they need a slight virtual occupation of the doubly occupied state, otherwise they cannot manage that, and that's why it's only possible when the J of epsilon is on here. So much about the qubit control. Now there's one place that is quite important and for, well, auxiliary features of the qubit or operation, and that's this crossing between T plus and singlet. If you zoom singlet 0,2, if you zoom in on that, you also find that this isn't an exact crossing, but has a slight gap here. And that gap is proportional, it turns out, to the transverse or the gradient of the transverse magnetic fields. So if the fields perpendicular to this Zeeman field here are different in the two dots, this opens a gap. Spin orbit coupling can also contribute to it. And this is important for talking to nuclear spins. I'll come to that later. So if you like the kind of Hamiltonians, or more the theoretically inclined, here's what helps to, or is useful or sufficient to analyze most aspects of the qubit. Of course, you can always add features, spin orbit coupling, or additional states when they become important. If you're just working in the logical subspace of the qubit, where the exchange coupling and the Zeeman field gradient is much smaller than the external field, so we live out here, and these other states are far away in energy, we can ignore them. Then we just have a two-level Hamiltonian with the exchange coupling determining splitting between J and S, and delta BZ, this is now the singlet triplet basis, the delta BZ determining the coupling that mixes the two, drives one onto the other. So I've just done a basis change compared to what I've explained before, considering the Bloch sphere along this axis, with this being the computational states. If you go a little bit further, you can do this for all spin states, S, T naught, T minus, and T plus. And for example, here are these states that, or these matrix elements that mix singlet and T plus that are given by the transverse field gradients. Details, of course, in the literature. All right. So much about a little bit of theory. Any questions on that? All right, so let's get back to the lab and discuss on how to actually make use of that in real experiments. Well, I'd first like to go through the somewhat basic issue, but you know, I've always said, well, let's capture two electrons and then juggle them around. How do we actually get two electrons? I mean, you know, you start from lots of them. So a key technique for that are these charge stability diagrams. So what you see here is the conductance of this charge sensor, which, remember, changes whenever an electron jumps in or out of the dot as a function of the gate voltage on these big two gates. So if you sweep the left one, you mostly control electrons in this dot, but also a little bit this one. If you sweep the right one, it's the other way around. So as you sweep these every now and then, you see this sharp line with some pattern here. And each transition here corresponds to moving one electron in or out of the dot. So you know when electrons are added or not. Once you get it right, there's a linear background subtracted because there's direct coupling to the sensor, but that's the main idea. And once you go far enough into negative voltages, you don't see any transitions anymore. So if you do things right, you know there's no electron left, and this calibrates your zero-zero state. And then you just count from there, okay, you add one electron to the right dot, so this is zero in the left, one in the right. Same the other direction. Here you have the 1-1 state with the two electrons. 0-2 would be here. And then to operate the qubit, to go to where this the energy diagram is valid, we want to be at the transition between 1-1 and 0-2. So one would zoom in on this region. This would be a magnified charge scan, and then work around here and forget about all the rest. For the say most widespread principle, of course, you can think of many other things. For example, it could be interesting to work in the middle here, where the qubit talks to both 0-2 and 2-0 up here, but that's the standard approach. So once we have now our transition, we start to do pulsing. And typically one applies nanosecond scale gate voltage pulses, so no microwaves really. These are just connected directly to the similar AWGs that some of you know from other qubit experiments. So we can update the voltage here about once every nanosecond and then move around, since we have two gates that are both controlled in this charge stability diagram. So I've superimposed now these gate voltages onto the scan. And the typical sequence would look like this. You somehow start here at this measurement point, but then first want to initialize the qubit, reload at this point, so you move here. This now allows both electrons to decay into a singlet state by exchange with the lead. So if you're in a triplet state, one electron hops out, another one hops in again, you fall into a singlet. That's just what happens beyond this boundary. Then you go back here, for example, separate the electron into 1-1, do your qubit dynamics, and in the end, to read out the state, which I think I'll say later more in more detail, you come back to this measurement point where you distinguish whether it's a 1-1 and 0-2 state, which maps onto a singlet or triplet, or vice versa. Depending whether it's a singlet or a triplet state, you get a 1-1 or 0-2. So basically, all the experiments I'll discuss in some way move around this charge diagram with two-dimensional gate voltage pulses like this. So let's see, do I say something for readout? I have that here. Well, just in case it's not there later. No. Right, here comes readout.
Can I ask something about this blocking triangle? And you would think naively that the shape of that triangle, or the edges of that triangle, would just be the continuation of the stability lines.
Right, that's right. So
it seems like they're not quite.
It's not quite. So what David says, that the edges of this triangle here is a metastable region where the triplet, which in this case was initialized with pulses that ran parallel to the scan, is metastable. So you see this 1-1 region with half the contrast roughly extended 0-2. Then if you go outside the triangle, the triplet can decay quickly and you get back this light blue singlet contrast. And so this decay is possible whenever the an exchange with the leads is possible. So if the triplet can jump out into a lead and the singlet can go in. And that condition is the same as the transition from 1-1 to 0-1. So this means that this instability line should somehow continue there. In principle, that's also the case. You already see they're parallel, but there's thermally activated processes that basically shift this line roughly by one line width, and that's why they're not exactly aligned. If you look very carefully, also you see that the tip of the triangle is chopped off. Sometimes that's much more dramatic. It could end here or even further. That's because if you go back quite some way, at some point the triplet also changes to 0-2. It's typically a few hundred micro EV, and this varies a bit from sample to sample because it depends on the exact shape of the dot. So you can also see that in these triangles. All right, so these are all things that, well, are pretty much standard and are given, taken for granted in many experiments, but to design, run experiments and really understand the details, one someone needs to go through all that. So in a somewhat extended setting, thought would be useful to go through that. All right, so now how do we, or any other questions? Yes?
Is the lens quantum point contact sensitive to the diagram in the right block?
Right, so the question is the left quantum point contact that we use for readout sensitive to the electron on the right? So you can kind of see that here. The biggest contrast is from dark blue, well, biggest is from dark blue, which is a 0,1 to 1,2 to bright. These are the extreme states. Then if you add the right electron, I think we're actually probably measuring the left. If you go from 0,1 to 0,2, so you add something to the right dot here, there's a smallish step, say a third of the contrast. If you go from the 0,1 to the 1,1, you add something to the closer dot, you have a bigger contrast, roughly twice this big from dark blue to orange. So yes, they're sensitive to both, but the sensitivity is about a factor of two different. What we mostly use for readout then is the difference between 1,1 and 0,2, which is just the difference of the two electrons. All right, so now how do we read out this qubit? This is very similar to what I discussed with the Pauli blockade. Basically, this picture was the spins jumping across the dot yesterday and sometimes being blocked. It's nothing but this energy diagram. The singlet can tunnel to 0,2. The triplet is stuck in 1,1 until it has more energy over here. So this gives you the more formal explanation of that, and it's really more the singlet and triplet states rather than parallel and anti-parallel. And now we use a very similar, it's actually a combination of this transport picture and the charge sensing to read out this qubit. And you see that the singlet can, if you go from negative to positive, the singlet can tunnel into 0,2. So the electron transfers to the right, whereas if you're in a triplet, say here for demonstration purposes, T plus, this tunneling isn't possible. So even though it would be energetically favorable to go down here, because the spins are in a relatively long-lived triplet state, they stay in an excited state up here. So this relaxation from triplet to singlet for positive epsilon is forbidden. And this means that the spin state of the qubit, or the two electrons that we're interested in, is now mapped onto a charge state, which dephases quickly, but is still relatively long-lived. And we can detect this difference between two electrons in one dot, or two separated, using our charge sensor. So this is nothing but the contrast between 1,1 and 0,2, which also gives the measurement contrast. All right, so far, or initially, this was all done with ordinary DC transport with lock-ins, integration time constants of milliseconds to seconds. But if you want to do real quantum information experiments, it's nice to have single-shot readout, meaning you can distinguish the two states of a qubit in a single attempt in each experimental run. You don't always need that many. It's often to just average over many gate pulses and look at the average charge signal, because often you're just interested in expectation values anyway. Then one, well, can use relatively slow techniques. But in the end, it's nice to have this single shot. It becomes vital if you want to do quantum error correction, because you want to know, has an error occurred in this particular instance or not? You just don't want to have, or don't just want to have the average error rate. If you want to verify entanglement, you need to have correlations between qubits. And that also means that you need to measure them individually and see that they both get an up at the same time or different states. So for most advanced experiments, it's important to have this single shot readout. And then, of course, you can also run more fundamental studies, study, for example, the properties of projective measurements. And finally, if you can measure quickly, you can measure a lot, so your data acquisition becomes faster. One thing that's actually quite nice about these qubits, in particular to comparison to superconducting qubits, where you need to work fairly hard to initialize the qubit rapidly, or you wait a long time, here we can just, by moving around in this energy diagram, basically going to here, we can relax the qubits into their singlet ground state very quickly in a few nanoseconds and with a, well, in theory, very high fidelity. I say in theory because no one has really bothered to characterize that. It looks perfect compared to other effects. You know, very high meaning 10 to the minus 5 if you take a similar typical splitting and thermal excitation. There's probably other errors, but as I say, they're not very big and haven't been focused on. All right, so how do we do fast readout? Now comes a little bit of RF engineering. To measure these small kind of nanoampere scale currents through either the quantum point contact or also the sensing dot, you need sensitive amplifiers. And you make amplifiers sensitive by cooling them down, but then they work better at high frequencies. Furthermore, you'd like to have a high bandwidth to read the qubit within about a microsecond or so before it decays. And this is done with a, well, standard microwave readout circuit. I'm sure this will be familiar to many of you. One challenge here is you basically want to measure this conductance through the quantum point contact quickly. The intrinsic impedance of this quantum point contact is one channel of conductance. So the conductance is set by E squared over H, just by natural constants, which turns out to be on a scale of 10 kiloohms. Typically, you don't have the full value, so it's maybe 50 kiloohms. But anything high frequency likes to have something in the range of 50 ohms. You get most easily equipment that has exactly 50 ohms. So somehow you need to match 50 kiloohms to 50 ohms. If you connect that directly to some RF line, it just looks like an open. There's basically no conductance. You don't get much signal. And for that purpose, one uses a tank circuit consisting of a roughly microhenry resonator or inductor on the chip next to the sample. You can also put them on chip, but this is good enough. Combined with a parasitic capacitance gives an LC resonator that is designed such that it matches the impedance of this device to the 50 ohm impedance of a coaxial line. And therefore, one can send the signal this way, measure how much of the signal is reflected back. This measures the reflected amplitude, not the phase, as you may know from most superconducting experiments. We do have dissipation here. And then you measure that at room temperature and get a fairly fast signal. The readout circuit here just briefly goes through that. You send an excitation signal down, goes to the qubit. It's attenuated quite heavily, so that is roughly minus 80 to minus 100 dB at the dBm at the qubit. Goes through a directional coupler, then goes to the qubit. Depending on the conductance of the quantum point contact, more or less of the signal is reflected back. This goes to a cold amplifier and more amplifiers, and then it's mixed with the original signal for reference to do a phase-sensitive measurement, and then amplified either into an oscilloscope or data acquisition board. So in the end, it's nothing but high-frequency lock-in measurements working at a frequency of about 200 megahertz, 250, and the bandwidths you typically get is 10 megahertz, which is set by this tank circuit. Okay, what can we do with that? So here's a typical time trace from the first experiments really using this single shot readout to measure qubits, and since then it's pretty much turned into a standard technique. What you see here is the sensor signal from this readout after a little bit of filtering as a function of time, the real lab time in microseconds. The blue regions are the measurement period where one stays at this charge discrimination point. And then the white ones are pulses where the qubit is manipulated. So whenever you have a white one, a new qubit state is initialized and you're interested in what it is. And you see that the signal has some noise, it wiggles around, but sometimes it's mostly up, sometimes it's mostly down. So you can already kind of see two levels. To analyze that further, one would then average over an appropriate amount of time, a few microseconds. And if you bin these measurement signals according to the voltage level here. This is a histogram. You see that we basically get two roughly Gaussian peaks, one around the lower level that can be identified with a singlet, and one around the upper level corresponding to the triplet. So it's a very nice example where this von Neumann postulate that you measure quantum states and always get one answer or the other can really be seen in the lab. If you ask, is your qubit in one state or the other, you never get an intermediate value up to amplifier noise. You either get the singlet or the triplet. So it's, well, basic quantum mechanics working in the lab. Now, these states are not live for or don't live infinitely long. At some point, the excited triplet will decay into a singlet on a scale of tens of microseconds. So it's important that this measurement is carried out quickly enough before this decay can happen. Well, and then the peaks are not finite. That's just due to amplifier noise that add additional uncertainty. So then this has been improved even further, and this gives you a nice idea of the fidelities that are possible in the system, though I should say that it's not always routine to reach them. What we have done here is to replace the quantum point contact with another quantum dot. And now, rather than just opening or closing the channel, if you change the occupancy here, it basically makes it possible or impossible for electrons to hop onto this intermediate quantum dot. It's operated, say, like a single electron transistor. If it's a high energy, they cannot make it from the lead onto the dot and on, so current flow is blocked. This turns out to give a bigger transconductance and is more sensitive. In the end, the insensitivity was found to increase by roughly a factor of 3. And you find here now that this was the histogram that I've shown on color plot as a function of averaging time. You see that as you average longer, the noise is reduced. You have more separated peaks, but also you make errors because the qubit could decay. If you compare this now, you see that already after about 1 microsecond of averaging, these two peaks are clearly separated. And then after 2, there's, well, several sigma difference. So in this paper, they don't even bother to comment on the fidelity, but you can see that it can be pretty high in the high 99, I would think. But as I say, often it looks more typically like, well, down here, so routine measurements. Yes?
Is there any difference so on how the measurement affects the qubits? Both Q and D, or
it's essentially both Q and D, so you have a rapid defacing, but to a first approximation, the state itself isn't disturbed. If you measure a singlet, you get a singlet, and or it stays in a singlet, and vice versa. If you look closely, you do see that, for example, the noise of either type of sensor affects the qubit. So if you turn the power too high, the excited state decays more quickly, and the ground state is excited a little bit. And there hasn't really been a close study or detailed study, experimentally at least, on some theory work. Your neighbor might be able to tell you something about that. But experimentally, it hasn't really been studied what the trade-offs are in that respect. It basically works well enough to use it and hasn't been so much in the focus of the attention. With one exception where there was a bit of a misinterpretation of earlier data and then turned out to be an artifact of the readout, which then led to a somewhat more detailed study. But it's an interesting history of science under the keyword of Zamboni effect, how, well, something like 4 or 5 theory papers explained an effect that probably didn't exist. But but other than that, it's, well, a short episode, but not so relevant in the big picture.
Yes. I noticed this. I think this week the group of Jason Petta at Princeton announced another addition to this set of technology, which is that they had a superconducting amplifier as an additional preamplifier. And I wonder if you have any opinion about whether that's, well, I guess if you had the choice of doing this or that as sort of the next thing. Which is more valuable?
It's, well, this or that. I think these sensing dots are commonplace and it's simple to do. So that's certainly the first thing I would do and we routinely do to get the higher sensitivity. Now, maybe a bit about these superconducting amplifiers. You see here we use a semiconductor amplifier that gets a noise temperature of about 1.5 or 2, 3 Kelvin or so, operated at 4 Kelvin. So the noise temperature tells you how much. What temperature would you need to have the same amount of noise as the amplifier has from a resistor? And that is about the best you get from semiconductor amplifiers because they self-heat. Now, what the superconducting qubit guys have developed, because their signals are essentially much weaker than ours and they are lost without that in most cases, are parametric amplifiers that are optimized for very low temperatures based on nonlinearities in superconducting circuits. And they reach noise temperatures, I think, in the range of 50 millikelvin. So if you add these as first amplifier stage, you can, of course, get much higher sensitivity. And with specialists in Princeton sitting next door, it's not surprising that they eventually did that.
Yeah, their advertisement is they now acquire, you know, full charge backgrounds that video graphics.
Yeah, but you know, it takes longer to think about them than in video, so it doesn't make much of a difference. It's it would boost the fidelity a little bit, of course. You could do maybe do measurements on the scale of the dephasing process and study measurement back action as it happens, so basically doing quantum limited measurements. There's certainly interesting things in there. But it adds more complexity to this, and it's in some sense, I would say, a complexity that in many cases one doesn't need. Also, you need to worry about magnetic fields of these parametric amplifiers. It's solvable, but needs to be considered. I'd actually like to comment on a different thing that I found recently also from the Delft group, Leven's group, studied in 2007, which is a much simpler approach, which actually works surprisingly well, but hasn't been followed up since then very much. So here you still use a semiconductor amplifier, but no RF. It's just placed actually not so close to the sample. This is at 1 Kelvin. Sample is at the mixing chamber of the fridge. So there's a line with some like 50 picofarads capacitance between them. And they just put the voltage from the quantum point contact onto the gate of a field effect transistor that works well at low temperature. It's a high electromobility transistor, the same that's used in these high frequency amplifiers, and then amplify that further. And well, if you look at the time traces here, this is 1 millisecond. These are just different traces of qubits jumping up and down. And you can quite clearly distinguish signals or jumps that are on the scale, I would say, 10 microseconds or so. So with this much simpler readout, especially, you know, the circuit diagram doesn't look so much simpler. But if you compare this thing, these guys are all fairly bulky, burn a lot of power. You know, it's boxes this big, especially at low frequencies. Typically one puts in an additional circulator, which is also big. So these are not really scalable if you want to put many of them onto the chip and have an integrated readout solution. Whereas this Hemd amplifier is just a piece of semiconductor. The active part of it is a few hundred microns and can be made smaller. So it works fairly well. I think it can be optimized further. If you really think about the power budget, you could move this down here, get rid of capacitance, get even bigger signals. Maybe modify the sensor a little bit to boost the input signal. And then I think you could get the same performance as with all these IF techniques. But especially in the long run, if you think of a fully integrated quantum processing device, this looks like a very interesting option, and the performance is not very, is pretty good. So I was a little bit surprised that this hasn't been used more in follow-up experiments. So that goes in the opposite direction from adding more complicated RF engineering. And it's actually, you know, if you think about the trade-offs of superconducting, semiconducting qubits, you get a lot away with a lot of low tech in terms of RF. They don't need that much filtering. They're less infrared sensitive. You need lower frequencies for many experiments. So I'm quite curious if in the long run that could turn out to be an advantage that is maybe underestimated right now. All right, so summarizing the readout, we use the spin to charge conversion using spin or Pauli blockade, mapping the spin onto a charge state. We then distinguish the charge state before the metastable excited state can decay. Typical experiments, or the best, still rely on this RF reflectometry, and the fidelities are certainly higher than 90%, depends a little bit how much you push it. So much about the basic control. Before I get more into refined control and coherence, I'd like to, well, put or extend the trajectory of qubits and portray another qubit that now doesn't need any magnetic field gradients and uses exchange only to control the field or to control the qubit. And that was actually, well, a lot of the initial developments have been carried out in 2000 by our school organizers. So the idea is to now use 3 electron spins. And that means you have 2 exchange couplings between the left and the center and center and the right. So it's enough to have them in a linear chain. You don't need coupling between all 3 of them. So the interesting parts of the Hamiltonian are these two exchange couplings, plus of course the Zeeman shift. And we've said that in order to fully control the qubit, you need to somehow have two axes on the Bloch sphere that you can control. In the single spin, this was the transverse and the Zeeman field, so you need at least AC control in the transverse field. For the single triplet qubit, we at least needed a field gradient in order to have one axis and then control the J coupling on the other axis. But you need this field gradient, and creating a big field gradient on this scale of a few hundred nanometers is not all that trivial. So you can do it, but you don't just apply a big Helmholtz coil around it, because that wouldn't produce big gradients. So here the idea is to get away with field gradients altogether and just use exchange coupling. Now you have three spins, so you can again ask, what are your computational states? Here they're placed on the Bloch sphere. But if you look at what these computational states 1 and 0 actually are, well, first of all, one uses a subspace with a well-defined Z quantum number. Now you have three spins. The ones that are chosen most conveniently are the ones with plus or minus 1/2. And one way to construct it is to put two electrons into a singlet and then just add a spin 1/2 on the right, and that actually makes one computational state. Well, and then for the other one, it turns out to be convenient, because those are eigenstates of the corresponding Hamiltonian, to use a superposition of, or entangled, well, superposition of two states that consist of a T0 with a spin up. So this would be the natural counterpart, in a sense, to this one. This would just be a single triplet qubit with an extra spin added. But then you add to that one where the, you have a T plus with a down spin, and you see that both of these, again, have M equals plus 1/2. Now, how are these controlled? You can, again, place these on the Bloch sphere. If you do that with these two states, it turns out that one exchange coupling rotates around the Z axis, but this second exchange coupling rotates around the non-orthogonal axis. That's rotated by 120 degrees from this z-axis, so it's down here. So you see you do have two different rotation axes that can be used to control the qubit. Now, how do gate sequences look like? There's just some example that mainly to illustrate what the, well, advantages and disadvantages or possible challenges are. If you a typical single qubit operation, not sure which one this is, that was demonstrated, something missing here, back or proposed back in 2000, could be something like four steps, but of course if you just want to go around one axis, you can also do with one step. So this, okay, it's not so bad. But then if you look at two qubit operations, they may have improved a little bit by then and shortened somewhat, but it still gives a representative characterization. You end up with a fairly complicated sequence of different couplings between the two qubits in a row. So you imagine one of these, then another one here, and these are exchange coupled. So in this case, it was 27 steps. You can condense that to, I don't know, do you have a number in your head? 18 is, I think, if you run them all in parallel. Maybe you can skip a few by being more efficient, but it's certainly a non-trivial thing to implement that and have everything calibrated.
At ETRL, they improved it quite, but it's still not two steps.
Right, and it's unclear how much they, how far they are experimentally, right? Yes?
So, in the slide before, is it clear why there is this difference in amplitude, so why there is this square root of two?
You mean this guy here?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, this thing is probably not normalized, and basically, let's see, it has to do with this 120 degree angle, and just turns out to be the correct eigenstate. I couldn't give a very simple one-line explanation. Do I have something on that?
Explanation. These are eigenstates, not only a S sub Z operator, they have a Z angular momentum of plus 1/2, but they also have total angular, well-defined total angular momentum. Quantum number, which is 1/2 also. So that's what determines the coefficients. It's a kind of
coefficient. And one way you can also argue, whoop, where am I? Here. If you now swap these eigenstates, it's equivalent to swapping these two axes. It's the symmetry of the qubit, so we now would take a state the original one zero eigenstate would now be on this axis, and therefore the other eigenstate now, well, is rotated by 120 degrees, and that is just this prefactor. All right, any other question? We'll come to experiments soon. All right, so how far are these experimentally? These have been pursued around 2013 in the Marcus group and work quite nicely. So here you now see a triple quantum dot, which by the way also shows that you can nicely add, well, put a couple quantum dots side by side, have them tunnel coupled in both directions, takes a slightly smaller spacing than in the samples before, but works nicely. Then you get a somewhat more complicated charge diagram because you now have three dots and probably scratch your head for a while what all these things mean, but eventually can identify them much in a similar way as before. And the interesting, well, the tuning axis here is now the one that again shifts electron from the left to the right. So you start as two electrons on the left, zero in the middle, one on the right, then have a state where they're all separated, or all in one dot, and then the symmetric state with two electrons on the right. And if you go through this exchange Hamiltonian with magnetic fields as a function of this detuning, the total number of electrons fixed, you again find an stability diagram analogous to the one we've discussed that looks like this. So you have, let's see, the computational states are shown in blue and red here. And then, depending on where the parameters are, if you go to the left or to the right, one of the exchange couplings becomes big. So if you go towards this transition, this left exchange couple J gets big. On the right exchange gets big. So this is where this level splitting opens up. But then there's a stationary point where the two states are locally parallel in the middle. And then there are some additional states around here that, again, are non-computational. Since they're more spins, they're more non-computational states. And here's actually a representation of the Bloch sphere that's a little bit less crowded and rotated. So here they have, you have again the 2J axis with the corresponding with the eigenstates. So with respect to these axes, either singlet between the left two or the left pair or singlet between the right pair. And these are 120 degrees apart, and they have defined now the 0 and 1 just symmetrically between them, which would correspond to these states in the middle here. Then you can, again, do pulsed experiments. Here, just some example is the same level diagram. You pulse along this epsilon axis plus some deviations for initialization. So, for example, you start from 2,0, then pulse into 1,1. And find some kind of Rabi-like oscillations, basically from switching on the coupling terms and switching them off again. This is a model, this is data, so it works reasonably well. And one can combine several of these pulses and calibrate them to exactly to know reasonably well what they do. And then, for example, reconstruct the trajectory of some state around the Bloch sphere using time-dependent state tomography. So each dot here is a complete measurement of the density matrix using different pulses, and you see the trajectory of a quantum state measured in many repetitions, so standard technique, as a function of evolution time. Now they've then added an interesting twist to this qubit, and that is now to say, okay, let's work at this point where you have a fairly large exchange splitting between the two states. And now just do Rabi control by wiggling in this direction, and you can understand that quite well on this Bloch sphere. If you're sitting in the middle here, the J left and the J right are of equal magnitude, so you do a vector addition, means your total evolution axis is vertical, just between 0 and 1, as you would expect. But if you now wiggle between left and right, the level splitting remains the same, so you're to lowest order insensitive to charge noise. But you see that this vector tilts a little bit to the left and right. So this is the same thing that you would do to a single spin by applying an in-plane field. And that means you basically have a Rabi control Hamiltonian and can drive Rabi oscillations. And that's exactly what they show here. So here you see a spectroscopy scan of just this level diagram. And the biggest feature, most obvious feature, is just this avoided crossing corresponding to this transition here. And then there's some more that correspond to what happens on the far left and right. So ignore these mostly. If you then sit at this point and look at the qubit probability as a function of frequency, so detuning from the resonance, and the function of time, the pulse is applied. You see this chevron pattern that is typical for RB control. So it's the same that we've discussed yesterday, now put into a the color scale diamond. As a function of time, you see oscillations between 0 and 1. As you detune from the resonance frequency, then you add basically in the rotating frame a Z component to the Hamiltonian, which means your total frequency gets bigger. You see faster oscillations, but because you rotate around the different axes in the rotating frame, the visibility goes down, and you often see these diagrams and characterization measurements. All right, so now we've seen a bit of a zoo of qubits, 1, 2, and 3 spins, to give you an idea of the trade-offs and advantages. Put together this trade table. In general, you can say as you add spins, control in some way becomes simpler. You need less different ingredients, but at the expense of complexity. So for example, if you look at for a triplet qubit, for exchange or for magnetic field, for a single spin you need a magnetic field, then for single triplet qubit you somehow need this gradient, and for the exchange qubit it's useful for initialization to have a external field, but everything I've said works just as well if you have 0 external magnetic field and just work with exchange splitting. If you look at AC control, here you need transverse for single spins, you need transverse magnetic fields or effective magnetic fields, and well, it's not trivial to generate these with sufficient amplitude, whereas here you only need exchange, so that's relatively simple, electrically controlled, and can be relatively slow. There's different mechanisms for the 2-qubit gates, but then you see if you look at the number of steps in a 2-qubit gate, here you do it in one step. This basically this exchange operation on individual spins can be seen as a 2-qubit gate. For 2-electron spins, you need maybe 2 to 6 steps. Details follow. Whereas we have this large sequence of 19 steps if you run a Sun parallel that we've discussed before. So you see they all have different challenges. My feeling is that for gallium arsenide, where nuclear spins are a bit of an issue and you need very fast control, the single triplet qubit is a pretty nice sweet spot. But in other materials, single spins are more attractive, and there's a pretty large group at HIL in the US pursuing the single triplet qubit in silicon germanium. So we'll see how they prevail. All right, maybe this is a good time to short break, continuing at 10 or so. Again, feel free to ask questions and we'll continue with decoherence. What I'd like to start now is discussing decoherence, first a little bit in general terms to, well, lay out some basic concepts and a little bit of formalism that is in some sense the very minimum one needs in, for example, to interpret experiments, and I only scratch the surface, but I think it's useful to at least have seen that. It won't be new to many of you. And I wasn't sure if the theorists would do something that trivial, so I thought I'd try to cover that. Maybe there's some repetition. And then focus a lot on the hyperfine interaction, which is the dominant decoherence mechanism in gallium arsenide. And, well, actually not necessarily dominant, depending on where you are, but it's certainly the most interesting one and pretty rich physics. Very nicely understood, so well, you'll see for yourself. And then q-qubit operations, high fidelity control, and scalability, probably then tomorrow. So why is decoherence a big issue? And well, one thing is of course that qubits are essentially analog. You have continuous rotations. So any small deviations from what you actually want to do can already constitute an error, unlike digital circuits where there's only 0 or 1s and there's no, well, a 0.9 is still as good as a 1 as long as it doesn't cross the threshold. So it doesn't have this built-in, or at least in an obvious way, this built-in fault tolerance. But there's also a more profound reason which makes quantum computing interesting and hard, and that is you use superposition states, so the phase is important. And whenever you have a phase between two quantum states, the no cloning theorem says that whenever you learn something about the phase or the whenever you learn something about the two states, is it in the up or down state? So if you do some measurement or the, some information is transferred to the environment where you don't know about it, but it's still some kind of measurement on the system, then the phase information is distorted. Every measurement has a back action that kills phase information. So that means you need to have a very high degree of isolation of your qubit from any leakage loss into the environment. But then on the other hand, you want to control your qubit. You somehow need to, well, be able to tell it what you do. You need to eventually read it. So there needs to be some channel out. You cannot just take a spin, place it in free space, and say, okay, it's a good qubit. And also qubits have to interact, and that's the most challenging part. So two of these small entities have to talk to each other. So it's not good enough to just isolate the qubit. You need to have very tight control over a fairly high dynamic range of the interactions. You want to couple to those things, or couple strongly to the things you want to couple to. Ideally strong enough to do fast qubit operations, not build a very slow quantum processor. On the other hand, anything you don't have control over, you don't want to couple to, and that's what makes the thing hard. Now you'd think, well, maybe that's impossible. Analog computers also haven't taken off. But luckily, error correction tells us, and details, well, refer to Barbara's lecture, for example, yesterday, and another one today, I think. Anyway, or maybe they're over. Tells us that you only need, on the order of, depending on what exactly what approach you use, say 10 to 3 coherent oscillations or operations before one error occurs. If you can do that, you can correct errors. What is actually a quite exciting development in the field is that this number of 10 to the 3 has come down from something more in the range of 10 to the 4, 10 to the 6 in the last couple of years with the invention of new error correction schemes. And I think that's a big boost to the practical applicability of quantum information. So it's, you know, nice to see how theory and experiment progress together. And there are now several architectures that reach these gate fidelities. I think both for, well, for several, yeah, for single and two qubit gates, at least, are in that ballpark. And room for improvement. Now, how do we describe decoherence? On the one hand, well, the simplest level is at the Bloch sphere. So when decoherence takes place, you go from a pure state on the surface of the Bloch sphere into the center of the Bloch sphere towards mixed states. If you have coherent oscillation that correspond to some state somehow evolving around the Bloch sphere, where you then measure some projection, if they go into the state, they process on smaller circles. You actually saw that back here. You know, as things decohere, they spiral towards the center. So that means the coherent oscillation somehow decay, and that's what is typically used to characterize it. There's one form of relatively trivial decoherence, well, depending on the point of view, which is energy relaxation. So if you're in an excited state, the qubit can give energy to the environment and relax to the ground state. Depending on the temperature of the environment, it's also possible to go the other way. This corresponds to a classical bit flip error. So in some sense, it's not a true quantum effect, if you like. You can see that from the example of the single spin measurements, you didn't need any coherent control to actually measure this relaxation. You just initialize a mixed state in the middle and then watch it fall down without any pi pulses. This is the time scale associated with this from NMR referred to as T1. So whenever you have here T1 time, it's the time for the qubit to relax from here to here. And if you ask where does it come from, well, in the simplest picture, at least, it's due to noise at the frequency of this level splitting. So you can think of this random Rabi drive resonant with this level splitting that relaxes the qubit. You need actually some quantum effects to have the one-way direction, but so it's quantum noise that causes relaxation without excitation. But essentially, it's the noise at the frequency. So that also means if you filter out high-frequency noise, it's relatively easy to improve T1. Now, practice, it's not very important for the kind of spin qubits that are most developed. So as I've said yesterday, in T1, the measured in gallium arsenide, the measured T1 times are up to about a second, and we basically treat that as infinity. You can certainly make mistakes that bring this down, but I think that's eventually the intrinsic limit of the devices, so we're not worrying much about it. At least there's more interesting problems.
And this for silicon, even by
power. Right, for silicon, well, you know, silicon, even the T2 is going through the roof, so, and yeah, T1 as well. If you look at other materials with strong spin orbit coupling, for example, indium arsenide nanowires, there the T1 can become an issue because it's spin orbit that mediates relaxation. There's things like exchange with leads that may become problematic, but it's much less of a problem than, for example, in superconducting qubits, where basically all the technical, or a lot of the technical progress over the last couple of years has really been based on very systematic and tedious improvement of material qualities to bring up the T1s from microseconds to milliseconds or so. Not only materials, also sample design, but well, sometimes you end up with these big chunky cavities. So it's, you can debate whether that's progress or not. I mean, it certainly is in some sense, but also, you know, feels back to vacuum tubes. Anyway, so the more interesting thing is, and more fundamentally quantum, is dephasing, which is a loss of the phase information, therefore dephasing, which happens due to the variation in the level splitting. So if you have some qubit state that is not computational or not an eigenstate, and the level splitting here, which is the precession frequency of this Bloch flector, fluctuates, then you have uncertainty in this precession frequency, and that after some time reflects an uncertainty of the phase of the qubit. And if you then average over many different states with different angles, that means you end up with a state that's closer to the center or fully defaced at the vertical axis of the Bloch sphere. There's two, in principle, there's infinitely many dephasing times because it depends on how you measure it in general and the noise you have. But one typically distinguishes two times when simplifying things, which is an accurate distinction if you have Markovian noise. One is the T2, which in some sense is true decoherence from fast uncorrelated noise. So if this level splitting fluctuates very quickly, then you find that there's an exponential decay towards the inside, and there isn't really anything you can do about it. Once the qubit has decayed, the information is lost, and well, you're lost. And this is really the thing that needs to be weak in order to, for example, execute error correction. Then there's another extreme referred to as T2 star, where during each experiment, this level splitting is constant. But as you repeat an experiment many times or on many different qubits, each repetition has a slightly different level splitting. So you get a dephasing from ensemble averaging. And there you can make use of the fact that on short timescales, this level splitting remains the same and does in some sense recover the apparently lost information using spin echo techniques or so. And that means it's, well, it can be a bit of a pain to deal with it, but there's no fundamental, or it doesn't impose fundamental limits. It just makes control more complicated. Now, there is a rough measure of,
yeah? What is fast noise mean?
Fast means uncorrelated on the scale of your qubit control. So basically white noise up to frequencies that are faster than the time scale in which you control the qubit. Of course, at some point, there's always some cutoff. Now, why is, how do you interpret T2 times? There's a very rough measure which says that a good figure of merit for a qubit is the duration of a gate with respect or divided by the coherence time. Because it tells you how many gate operations you can execute within the coherence time. This is an exactly good measure for an exponential decay in Markovian noise, where you don't have structure and frequency space. But otherwise, it's very easy to mislead and make pretty big mistakes by order of magnitudes, because in the end, the decay law of the coherence matters. So, you know, as a very simple proxy, it's useful to look at that. But don't be fooled when people oversell that and say, well, you have so much or so few operations, details can matter. Right, so I'd like to say a few things about how one, especially in the experimental context, models decoherence and describes it. One possibility is, of course, which we don't typically do, is to write down a full quantum model. So you have a qubit, you have some bath that it's coupled to, which is also some quantum system. Assuming quantum, you believe that quantum mechanics holds everywhere. And then there's some interaction term. For simplicity, I just take that to be proportional to sigma z. So it only dephases, but of course there can be other interactions. And well, yeah, you can simulate the whole thing, write the, or determine the density matrix of the whole system, or even a pure state vector. Well, typically you don't know the initial state of the bath, so it really is a density matrix. Then trace out the bath, so throw out all the degrees of freedom you don't care, and then get a time-dependent density matrix of the qubit, and that describes your coherence process. It's very nice, very general, but doesn't work well for simple systems. If you think of typical baths of, say, a million nuclear spins, or some kind of unknown charge traps, or fluctuations in your magnet, you're not going to write down a quantum model for that and solve it. So very nice for fundamental studies, but impractical. What's much more useful and widely applicable is a semi-classical picture, where, again, I'm assuming only dephasing. The qubit has some fixed level splitting, maybe also control Hamiltonians, but not so important. And then in addition to that, now C is a classical field that basically comes from the interaction with the bath. And because the bath evolves, this field is time dependent. But we are not considering any quantum fluctuations. We're just saying this is a, well, classical noise that has a well-defined number or value at any point of time. And there's no back action here, meaning that this noisy bath doesn't react to what you do to the qubit. And then it becomes much simpler, the qubit density matrix. Now you obtain that by averaging over many realizations of this noise process. So you're always interested in averages. So that means you repeat a measurement many times. This noise process then is assumed to be drawn from some distribution over which you can average. And after doing that average, you get the average density matrix. And if you only have this phase evolution, it turns out that, well, on the off-diagonal elements, you get a phase factor from the phase accumulation of the two-level system. So you need to take an average of this phase over your noise realization. And that describes how the qubit decoheres. And so you've basically reduced everything to taking relatively simple averages.
I guess you would agree that you don't use this to describe T1, but you say T1, from some point of view, is kind of classical, and yet, to really have a physical model for it, you need to be more on the left.
Right. It's true that if you want to do T1, you can, well, to a large extent, you can do nearly the same, except that you look at the sigma x here, and you look at the components that are resonant with the level splitting, because in the rotating frame, this just looks like the same as this. There's one thing. If you do this, you always move towards the center of the Bloch sphere. But you know that at low temperature, for the zero temperature bath, your qubit relaxes to the ground state. So this is something that this classical approach cannot produce for you. You can kind of add it by hand. It kind of comes in, there's a natural extension of this formalism that I'll actually address, where you distinguish between positive and negative frequencies of the noise. And these correspond to different directions of energy flow. And then you can also understand T1 effects. So in that sense, it's not too specific. But there's a nice review by, I think, Ajish Clark and some others that goes into the spectral density formalism quite nicely, and quantum noise in general. All right, so now how do we can simplify a little bit further and actually come to quite easily understand some of the basic relations. So as I've said, we want to average over different noise realizations to get this phase average. You know the phase is just given by, well, first of all, the so-called drift, or the deterministic evolution of the qubit, change variables here. And then you also integrate the fluctuating part of the level splitting over time. Now, this would be the phase for any particular realization of this noisy process. And then what's very handy is that if your noise is Gaussian, which often happens when there's many contributions to the noise due to the central limit theorem, then you can write this phase average. The interesting part, well, there's a mean phase, of course, but the decay just is an exponential with the variance of the phase in here. So that means for many purposes, all you need to do, and I could also say all that most experimentalists are able to do, because you don't know more about the system or don't have any access to additional information, with some exceptions, is to calculate this variance of the phase, which I've just written out here according to this formula. So it gets simpler and simpler. Now we just calculating variances. There are two cases that are worth knowing in your sleep, if you have anything to do with individual qubits and decoherence. One is this T2 star I've already mentioned. So qualitatively, it's slow, averaging over slow fluctuations. This means that the noise process is constant over each experimental run. Every time you initialize a qubit, let it evolve and read it out, during that time, this value of beta doesn't change. So that means the fluctuation here just depends on this variance of beta times t squared, which converts this into a phase. And if you plug that into the decay form, you get this Gaussian decay with a time scale called T2 star that is just given by the inverse width of the fluctuations. Another way of putting that is, you know, qubit oscillation is, well, oscillation with some frequency. If the frequency fluctuates, then you basically do a Fourier transform of the distribution of the spectrum, and the Gaussian distribution turns into Gaussian decay. So you end up with a Gaussian decay law. The second special case is the uncorrelated noise that I briefly mentioned before. If beta is completely uncorrelated, then you basically get square root n statistics, and it turns out that this variance, well, not so much of beta squared, but of the phase, so this value here is proportional to the time. So t squared turns into square root of t squared, and therefore t. And that means you get an exponential decay here of your phase coherences, and that's associated with the T2. If you see that, then there's really one well-defined T2 of the system that you can use reliably, with very few caveats, I would say, for estimating fidelities. Now, in practice, especially for solid-state systems, interesting solid-state systems such as spins, I mean, well, it makes the decoherence processes physically in some way more interesting, is that this noise has some broad spectrum that, well, typically has more low-frequency than high-frequency noise, but can have sort of different shapes. In addition, you can apply pulses to the qubit. A spin echo is the most familiar, but you can repeat that, and you still want to know what your qubit looks like or dephasing. And there's a wise, very nice, pretty general formalism that all boils it down to this integration. So you integrate over frequency, and what you integrate is, on the one hand, the noise spectrum of beta. So that's something that's typically quite well known or can be extracted from measurements or modeled. So it's the Fourier transform of the time correlator. And a filter function, this is just some function that depends on the evolution time and the frequency. It depends on the pulse sequence you apply to the qubit, so there's a whole zoo of them. Here I've just plotted a few generic ones. One is for the so-called free induction decay. You just initialize the qubit, let it wait. You see that this filter function here has a lot of wait at low frequencies, which means you're sensitive to these quasi-static fluctuations that occur over a long time, and often they are quite abundant. Then you can do a spin echo, where you invert the qubit once, and the filter function then shows, I'll discuss more details later, that has zero wait at low frequencies, and then some, well, at roughly the pulse spacing has the biggest wait, and then decays again. You can repeat pulses, add multiple pulses, then it increases more slowly. It's nearly flat initially, and so you're even less sensitive to low frequency noise. And for comparison, a typical spectrum for Lorentzian, which corresponds, for example, to an RC filtered white noise or a signal two-level fluctuator, this could look like this. So you have a fairly high amount of noise at low frequencies, and then it drops off, which is why a free induction decay often shows much faster decay. This integral is bigger, and this variance increases faster than if you use any of the other sequences. If you're interested in this and want to have a nice kind of working tool set for understanding, describing experiments, I would recommend this reference here. Where it's all laid out in relatively simple terms, but has most of what you need. All right, any questions on the formalism? All right, so good time to stop in a minute. So what are typical noise sources in real systems? We broadly distinguish two. On one hand, there's the local environment intrinsic to the qubit and how it's implemented. Here, these would be fluctuating spins, can be electron spins, but mostly nuclear spins, which are the, well, more serious aspect, more troublesome. Phonons are an example. Phonons are some more intrinsic fluctuations that are intrinsic to any solid state system. You can have charge traps, kind of mundane, but present in most devices. But then there's also electrical noise that is in some way man-made or extrinsic. So your pulse generators and voltage sources are typically noisy and can affect the qubit. There can be interference from the next radio station or transformers. Any resistor that is somewhere in the system will have Johnson noise or thermal noise from the resistor. All these need to be taken into account. They're generally avoidable by right engineering, but need to be considered in detail. And, well, sometimes takes work, but are not fundamental. Here, on the other hand, there's intrinsic ones. At some point, you hit pretty limits, hard limits of particular systems. So for example, nuclear spins, which I'll focus on later, you cannot get rid of in gallium arsenide. You need to move to different materials. Phonons seem to be less of an issue from all what's known so far, especially for dephasing and also relaxation, as I've said, this 1 second is not a problem. Charge traps, I think, have been, or charge noise has been somewhat underappreciated as an important noise source. It's also less interesting from the physics point of view. It's harder to understand and, well, more difficult to model. It depends a lot on the sample quality, and there certainly the community needs to do a little bit of work in any spin qubit material system. All right, so what I'll then continue with next time is really going into the concrete physics of hyperfine noise due to nuclear spins in gallium arsenide spin qubits, talk a little bit about how we can measure and manipulate this hyperfine field and by these techniques also reduce fluctuations. So somewhat non-standard way of beating decoherence. Control will probably come a bit later. And then also talk about coherence with these pulse sequences, dynamical decoupling and spin echo, which works quite well and also gives us a pretty detailed insight into the dynamics that leads to decoherence and makes nice fits and good physics. And then, as I said, 2 qubits, a bit of scalability, and try to give a bit of an outlook. All right, so see you again tomorrow, and I'll stay around for the break. So if anyone has more questions, stop by.